Hey guys, welcome back to the United Star. I have Atanu and Sid here with me, and we're here to review the match week two, the game week two that's just taken place this weekend. Before we start, I would like to tell you to like, share, and subscribe because it helps us a lot to reach out to more United fans like us, and we would like to enlarge our community, so please do that. But getting straight into it, obviously, we're a United channel, so we have to talk about the draw. A rather drab draw, like I said in the review also, that it was a reminder of last season where when the opposition sits back and holds a very defensive line, we're unable to break down, we're unable to get the goal, where we look very flat, the passing is very sideways. Atanu, what was your review of the game?
I think we got it wrong with the team selection, first of all. I like Ole, I love Ole, but nobody is above criticism. So yeah, he got it all wrong with the team selection. And then the players that he chose, he trusted the players like Martial and Matic, but they didn't repay his trust. So I think we got it wrong with the starting 11, first of all. And yes, this was a side which played with the low block, the Southampton side. So we should have gone with a bit more creativity. And that we lacked that because we were playing Matic and Fred in a double pivot. I know McTominay wasn't available because he had a knock. But, there are other players. There is Lingard, there is Donny van de Beek, who Ole could have integrated into the team. So, I think a very dull 1-1 draw. And Priyan is right that this shows the glimpses of last season. The games that we should be winning, we aren't winning. So, we aren't a title-challenging side yet.
Yeah, and not only that, Sid, this is already like 2 points off the top. And I know it's just the second week and it's just started, but looking at how City have been the last 3 years and Liverpool have gone, other than last season, the last 2 years, it's a very small gap between the top. So if you're missing out on these points here, this game itself might just come back to bite you. If you're going for the title. Sid, what do you think?
I completely agree with Atanu. First of all, the team selection was very weird. And the fact that he brought on an injured Scott McTominay and an unfit Jesse Lingard instead of Donny van de Beek, whereas the game was shouting out for a player like van de Beek, to ignore him, I think it's very, very, very wrong on Ole's behalf. I don't know what the reason is, because Donny scored his first goal against Molde or something. I don't know what it is. But I think everyone agrees that we've got a world-class player in Donny van de Beek and that he should be used more. And if Ole is not trusting using him, and if Ole is using an injured McTominay and an unfit Lingard over him, then, I mean, I don't want to say that, but what's the point of Donny van de Beek at the club?
Yeah, I think I agree with that. Moving on, obviously we had another very big game. We had the London Derby with Arsenal playing Chelsea at the Emirates.
And is it big anymore?
I don't think
Is it big anymore?
These are two historically big clubs who faced off, and I don't think anyone was shocked with the result. I think the only thing that shocked me was that Chelsea didn't get 4 or 5, because Arsenal have been so bad. And they've lacked, they've not had Aubameyang, Ben White had COVID, Lacazette wasn't there, Odegaard has just come in. So it's a very sort of second string side. What's the deal with Arsenal? I mean, we all know what the deal is, but what was the review of the game, Sid?
Well, so I was actually traveling for 2 hours when Arsenal played and United played. So I saw the whole United game in the car. And then I was so disappointed. I was frustrated because I was stuck in that Kandivali traffic. And I was so frustrated because we drew the game, which I expected us to win, like at least 3-0 or something. And then luckily for the second half of my journey, I saw Arsenal play Chelsea. And, that just lit me up. But again, I mean, this just shows what's going on at Arsenal, man. I mean, when you think of Arsenal nowadays, you don't remember the Invincibles or something. You just think of a club which... you can banter easily. Like the history, no one really cares about the old Arsenal anymore. Everyone's just bantering Arsenal. But yeah, I mean, pretty routine game for Chelsea. The squad they have, Big Rom is back and he's back with a bang. I think he bullied the Arsenal defense. But yeah, I mean, standard game. It's now become like a top versus mid-table game. You know, a routine 2-0 against a mid-table side.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I agree. And Atano, like Sid said, Romelu Lukaku looked like he's been playing for Chelsea for so long. His hold-up play was fantastic. He just bullied the defenders. They couldn't get around him. He should have gotten a second goal, but Leno had a world-class save. But otherwise, I think a very clinical performance from him.
Yeah, definitely. I think I'm really liking this Romelu Lukaku that has come to Chelsea. Of course, he's a rival right now, but at the same time, putting that aside, I think he's doing really well. And I'm really happy for him that he's enjoying his football again. And I mean, he bullied Pablo Mari and I was like, God, man, is Pablo Mari going to play another game for Arsenal after this?
Yeah.
But I mean...
Sorry, go ahead and I'll make my point.
Yeah, so it is like Arsenal do have good players, but they always depend on the individual brilliance of one or two players. So that's where they are getting it wrong. And I think once the players are back, maybe we'll get to see some improvement, but I hope they don't. Of course, they've signed Aaron Ramsdale. So, relegation.
I was just about to say that. But then again, what I wanted to say was you have to commend Ole on the job he's done. I mean, look at Lukaku bullying Mari and who was the other one? Was it Holding or someone? Right?
Yeah, Holding.
Before Ole came in, our two centre backs were Chris Smalling and Phil Jones. So if Mari and Holding are getting bullied, imagine what would happen to Phil Jones and Chris Smalling together, who were essentially a walking disaster. But I mean, you have to give Ole the credit for improving the team like this.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, we have to talk about City's demolition of Norwich City. I mean, obviously they had to get the win and they had to put out a statement performance after losing to Spurs in the first game week. But 5-0 clinical performance, Patano, like are they back on track now?
I think yes, maybe the first game was, I mean, yes, I won't take the win away from Tottenham Hotspur, but I think it was some kind of a fluke that they won 1-0. Of course, they were great, but I mean, the favourites were going to be Manchester City. And I mean, Norwich City, it's like they come into the Premier League and that season they get relegated. Then again, they win promotion. So it's a cycle that goes on. And I mean, yes, we saw Jack Grealish score a goal and doing the fake celebration that Pogba and Bruno did in the first game.
Yeah.
So, I mean, yes, 5-0, a very good win and the goal difference, of course, helps in the goal difference as well. I mean, yes, we all know that Manchester City have a perfect squad right now. Mahrez scored, Laporte scored, Sterling scored, Jack Grealish scored. So, yeah, it was obviously going to be Manchester City winning.
Yeah. And Sid, I want to talk to you about one more game. I think another very, very interesting game was West Ham-Leicester, where West Ham absolutely demolished Leicester 4-1. It was a very high-charged game with a red card, Jose Perez getting sent off straight away. But what I want to talk to you about this game was Antonio's celebration. What do you have to say about it?
It's a classic. It's going to go down in the history books. What a celebration that was. And the fact that he actually timed it, you know, before the match, he put his own cardboard cutout there and all. I mean, that was brilliant. It was some crazy foresight.
Coming into this game, I'm really impressed with Ben Rama. I mean, last season, we know that he had a quiet season. So everybody was a bit skeptical. Why did West Ham do this deal? And they did actually pay a lot of money to Brentford. But, you know, I've seen him play in the championship, like the highlights I've seen. And before Brentford were promoted, I saw a bit of their gameplay. So I was really impressed by Benrahma, Watkins, and of course, Ivan Toney. So I was sure that Benrahma was going to do something this season, and he's been doing really well. He scored in the he assisted in the first game and assisted one and scored one goal in this game. So obviously, Mikel Antonio is obviously the star player right now, but Benrahma is also doing a fantastic job.
Yeah,
I think
and
you're giving
one
him
more
so
thing.
much credit because you have him in your FPL team, but yeah, same one.
No, but I was actually looking forward to this specific game in this match week because West Ham and Leicester are two teams, like I've said, who are in the pole position to take over Arsenal's place in the big six, right? Because Arsenal's
yeah, traditional
not
big six.
Yeah.
Traditional big six.
So now Arsenal's gone. Who's going to replace them? And I think West Ham and Leicester are two teams. I'm pretty sure in the reverse fixture, it's Leicester who's going to get the win. But that's what I was looking because both of these teams have improved a lot in the last few years. And it's very exciting to see that. So the whole thing around West Ham and Leicester, I absolutely love it. So I think we should keep an eye out on both of these teams this season.
Yeah, and moving on, obviously Nuno has gone back to his old team, Wolves, with Spurs, and he's gotten the win 1-0. I mean, wasn't a very convincing win, but I mean, as long as they're getting the job done, right, Atano?
Yeah, definitely. I think Dele Alli scored from the penalty spot. And of course, it was going to be a bit, it was going to be a special occasion for Nuno going back to Wolves, like you said. And right now, I don't see, I mean, Harry Kane wasn't involved much in this game. He came on as a substitute. So if Harry Kane stays at Spurs, and I think he'll stay at Spurs, so maybe we can see a better Spurs side than last season. So of course they've got good players. They have obviously bought a few players as well. I think they've bought Romero, Brian Gill, and obviously they're trying to get in more players. So yeah, it will help the Nuno side a lot. And I'm looking forward to watching Nuno play with Spurs. So let's see what the season holds for them.
Yeah, and I think the last game that we need to cover is the Liverpool-Burnley game. Again, Liverpool getting the job done. 2-0, it's a Trent assist and Mane gets the goal. Diogo Jota gets the goal. Sid, what is the review of the game?
Again, like I said, standard, top team versus mid-table team game. 2-0, just like Chelsea-Arsenal. But yeah, I mean, one game I think you're missing is between two tactical geniuses. That is Everton versus Leeds, which ended in 2-2. I think that's one game we missed. And that too was a very exciting game, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think that Rafinha goal was... that was amazing.
Yeah. I had him in my FPL team, so I'm happy he scored. But yeah, Atanu, just getting back to the Liverpool game... obviously, Tsimikas is not going to be in the team once Robertson is back. But he's looking very, very good. He's looking like a fantastic replacement for Robertson. What is your opinion about him?
Yeah, I mean, definitely he's been playing really well. And, however short his game time is right now at Liverpool, he's trying to prove that, okay, you can't count me out. I'm also an alternative or I'm also an option to be in the starting 11. And of course, he was in my FPL team, so I'm happy. So yeah, he's doing really well. And I don't see him playing the next game against Chelsea if Robertson is back. So yeah, the Chelsea game, I think Liverpool are playing Chelsea. So that game will be a bit, interesting to see whether they'll keep a clean sheet or anything. But I'm looking forward to a draw at Liverpool-Chelsea. So let's see.
Now, moving on to the next week, we have some fantastic games lined up. We have City playing Arsenal. So, Arsenal could go three games into the season without a win and probably without having scored a single goal in their first three games.
Which makes us question, where's the goal of the month coming from?
Yeah,
training pitches.
Probably from their
training pitches.
Yeah. Yeah. We have Liverpool play Chelsea at Anfield. That's going to be a fantastic game, I think. Both looking, for that second. Chelsea are obviously pushing for the title and Liverpool are they want to regain their status after the last year where they weren't able to push really well. I think those are the most interesting games. Obviously, United play Wolves, but again, I mean, we need to win this game. After the draw, I think these are the games that you need to win if you want to even challenge for the title. Any other games you guys are excited about?
I think Aston Villa versus Brentford will be a good game. I think Brentford will put up a good fight. And, you know, people are saying that Brentford might get relegated, but in my opinion, they might just, you know, stay up. And Tottenham, Watford, I mean, yes, Tottenham will win. West Ham, Crystal Palace. I don't know whether Crystal Palace can, stun West Ham, but I think we'll have to see. Newcastle, Southampton, another good game between the mid-table clubs. So, so let's see.
Right. So anyway, guys, that's all we have for you today. West Ham are on top of the league as of now, but let's see how long that lasts. Do like, share, subscribe, and we'll see you guys in the next one.